Okay, it's a great pleasure to have Professor Carlo Giunti from INF in Torino give a talk on status of the reactor antineutrino anomalies and implications for active sterile neutrino mixing. So please.
Okay, thank you very much. And I'm very glad to give this seminar for KIAS. And it's a pity that I cannot be there. I like very much the place. And as you know, I've been there many, many times. So in this seminar, I will discuss the status of the antineutrino anomalies and in the context of active sterile neutrino mixing. And first, let me just remind you that we have a rather well-established paradigm of trineutrino mixing. That is the mainstream line of research in neutrino physics. And this has been proved by many experiments that neutrinos have masses, they mix, and the well-established neutrino oscillation data can be fitted very well in the framework of three neutrino mixing. In this framework, we have three flavor neutrinos, which are the three active neutrinos, nu I, nu mu, nu tau, that are admixtures of three massive neutrinos. And this is given by this relation that is the neutrino mixing with a neutrino mix 3x3 unitary mixing matrix. Using this mixing, one can derive the oscillation probabilities. And this is actually the general expression for the oscillation probability from one flavor to another flavor. So here my index alpha and beta denote a neutrino flavor. So it will be E, mu, or tau. And in the following, it can be also sterile. You can see that the oscillations depend on the elements of the mixing matrix and on the difference of the square of the neutrino masses. And then you have also a dependence on the source detector distance that is denoted by L and on the neutrino energy that is here. And in the framework of three neutrino mixing, there are three masses, so there are two differences. And this means that we can have only two independent delta M squares. And these are the so-called solar and the atmospheric delta M squares that are rather well measured. So their value is fixed. And the solar mass splitting is the smallest one, and the atmospheric mass splitting is at the level of 10 to the minus 3 electron volt squared. And so this delta M square can generate oscillations at a sufficiently long distance, because to see the oscillation, we need that this phase can develop. So if we have some fixed value of delta M square, we need to go to a sufficiently long distance to see some effect, so that this quantity is sufficiently different from zero. And this can happen only at a rather large, long distance, taking into account the values of the two delta M squares. So if we consider the oscillation due to the solar delta M square, then we can see these oscillations only if we go to a distance which is larger than about 50 kilometers for a neutrino energy of the order of 1 MeV. And I consider this energy because this is the typical energy of a reactor antineutrino. So it means that solar neutrino oscillation can be detected only by a detector which is at least for 50 kilometers away. The atmospheric delta M square is larger, and since the oscillation length is inversely proportional to the delta M squared, then these oscillations can be seen at a shorter distance, but still we need to be at least to 1 kilometer distance between the source and the detector. And this means that if we observe some oscillations at a shorter distance, this cannot be explained by in the framework of three neutrino mixing, because the time squares are too small. And as you probably know, there are some anomalies, so-called anomalies, that are these indications of short baseline oscillations that cannot be explained in the framework of three neutrino mixing. And these are the reactor anomaly, the gallium anomaly, and the LSND anomaly. So just say in words very shortly what they are. So the reactor anomaly is a comparison of the rates of measured in the detectors, which were placed at a short distance, like between 10 and 100 meters from the reactor. And these rates are, as you can see from this plot, are the ratio between the rates which were observed and the rates which are predicted by the flux calculations is less than one. So this shows that there is a disappearance of electron antineutrinos from reactors at short distances, and this is an anomaly that requires the existence of a new delta M square to generate this oscillation at short baseline. The gallium anomaly is a deficit also of electron neutrinos, which were observed in gallium experiment. So as you can see here, the ratios the average ratio is well below one with of the detected to respect to predicted number of events. And the LSND anomaly instead is an appearance experiment. So this is an appearance of electron antineutrinos in a beam of muon neutrinos. And you can see this is an excess with respect to the background, which is very clear. And this was observed at 30 meters for the neutrinos, which have an energy of between 30 and 50 MeV. And also this is some oscillation, which is at short baseline. So in order to explain this anomaly, since the oscillation length is inversely proportional to the delta M square, we need a larger delta M square, which we can call the short baseline delta M square. And as you can see here from this scheme, in addition to the three normal massive neutrinos, nu1, nu2, nu3, we need at least one additional massive neutrino at the electron volt scale in order to generate a delta M square, a new delta M square, which is of the order of one electron volt square. We can have more than one sterile neutrino, so there is no limit on the number of sterile neutrinos which is allowed, because sterile neutrinos don't interact, so we don't know how many there are, or maybe, so we can have more, but the simplest case is only one, so I will consider in the following only the possibility to have one additional sterile neutrino. And this will be the case of 3 plus 1, so-called 3 plus 1. So three actives plus one sterile. And here one must not be confused about the what we say that there is one sterile neutrino at the electron volt scale. So this means that there is one massive neutrino that in the flavor basis is almost entirely sterile, because you can see the sterile color is given by this magenta color here. So this nu4 is almost entirely sterile in the flavor basis, but it must have also some small admixture with the active neutrinos in order to generate the oscillations that we observe, because if it were completely sterile, then it will be completely not observable and it will not generate any effect that we can see. So we need some small admixture. And so the admixture of the active neutrinos with the fourth mass eigenstate, as is written here, must exist, but it must be very small because we want we construct a scenario in which we have just a small perturbation of the normal three neutrino mixing, because we need also to be compatible with the fitting of the atmospheric, solar, and long baseline data, which are fitted in the framework of normal three neutrino mixing. So we just make a perturbation of this framework that we call 3+1 neutrino mixing. And in this case, short base oscillations have a very simple form that is written here. So here I've written the probability of transition between one flavor to another in short baseline experiments. So these are the experiments that I will discuss in the following. And this is the so-called survival probability of some flavor. So this is the probability that is measured in the reactor antineutrino experiment for the when alpha is equal to E. So it's the electron antineutrinos. And as you can see, the probabilities are the same for neutrinos and antineutrinos because the probability depend on the elements of the fourth column of the mixing matrix, which is modulo square. So we don't have any difference for neutrinos and antineutrinos, and we don't have any observable CP violation effect in short baseline experiments. So in order to see the a difference, one need to go to other type of experiment like long baseline experiments. But in the short baseline experiments that I will discuss, there is no difference of the behavior of neutrinos and antineutrinos. And one important thing is that each type of oscillations, like a survival of electron neutrinos or of muon neutrinos, and also the appearance of nu mu to nu e, they depend always on the same elements of the mixing matrix, but they have a different expression here for the oscillation amplitude. But all these effective mixing angles are related because they depend on the same elements of the mixing matrix, and this will be important in the following when I discuss the global status. Let me just remind you, show you that typically one in the analysis of the experiment, tal data is also useful to use some parameterization of the mixing matrix. And the most useful and common parameterization is this one, in which one generalized the standard parameterization of the three neutrino mixing by adding three new mixing angles that are theta 1-4, theta 2-4, and theta 3-4 in this way. So multiplying the standard three neutrino mixing matrix by some appropriate rotations in the corresponding planes. And this is a convenient parameterization because in the limit in which these new mixing angles are zero, then one recovers the normal parameterization for three neutrino mixing. And it is also convenient because the line of the electron neutrino mixing is very simple, and also the column, the fourth column, is as simple as possible. And these are the quantities which are important for the analysis of short baseline oscillation experiments. So you can see that the disappearance of electron neutrinos that we will discuss in reactor experiments, they depend on UE4 modulo square. And this is just sine square theta 1-4. So this effective mixing angle that generated the oscillations in the reactor experiment is the same as theta 1-4. So people use different authors use either theta 1-4 or theta EE, but they are the same quantity. For the UMU4, it is slightly more complicated because here you can see UMU4 has also a contribution of theta 1-4. But it is through the cosine. So if we consider the fact that theta 1,4 is very small, then we can approximate the cosine to 1, and u mu 4 is practically equal. I mean, this effect in mixing angle theta mu mu is practically equal to theta 2,4. So there will be only a small correction to higher order. So let me now illustrate how the oscillation in reactor experiment can occur. So you can see here, these are the data, the probability that has been observed in reactor experiments compared with the calculated probability for different values of the new delta M squared, delta M squared for one, which is the short baseline delta M squared. So you can see that if we consider a delta M squared, which is rather small, like 0.1 electron volt squared, then the oscillations occur at a distance which is too large, and they cannot fit this data here. But if you choose, for example, a delta M squared, which is of the order of 1 electron volt, then the oscillation occur here. Then if you go farther, the oscillation average out, and we can fit this data. So this shows that in order to explain this data, we needed to have a delta M squared which is larger than about 1 electron volt squared. So and then if we go farther, then the oscillation due to delta M squared for 1 are average. And here we have starting the oscillation which is due to the atmospheric delta M squared. And these are the oscillations that are used by this experiment, Reno, Doubleshaw, and Diabay, to observe, to measure the theta 1,3. So this is due to the oscillation, atmospheric neutrino oscillations. And these are the near detectors of this experiment, and these are the far detectors. So by measuring this difference, they measure the value of theta 1,3. And also this plot is important because it shows that if there is some spectral distortion observed in this long baseline experiments, then this cannot be explained by short baseline oscillations, because you can see that here the oscillations are averaged. So there is no dependence here practically on the distance due to the short baseline delta M square, and also one cannot have spectral distortions. And this is important because we need to understand, reactor neutrino anomaly depends on the comparison of the rate measured in the experiment with respect to the flux which is calculated. And the flux is, this flux is calculated. So there is some dependence. The calculation of the flux is very difficult, and it is some uncertainty. So this reactor antineutrino anomaly is a model dependent anomaly that depend on the calculation of the flux. And so there are, as you probably know, there are some doubts on the validity of this calculation. And this calculation that I consider here is the so-called Huber-Muller calculation that was done in 2011. And a strong doubt on the validity of this calculation follows from the discovery around 2014 of the so-called 5 MeV bump. So by comparing the rate that the Reno, Doubleshaw, and Diabay measured in the near detector with the predicted spectrum, so they found an excess around 5 MeV. And this is a problem because it shows that there must be something wrong in the calculations. Because this bump cannot be explained by oscillations, as I argued, because here the oscillations are completely average, so they cannot generate a distortion of the spectrum. And this distortion of the spectrum cannot be explained by active sterile Newton oscillation. It must be explained with other means. And the most probable reason is the fact that the flux calculation is not correct, at least in this region. And for several years, there was a lot of discussion about this. And only recently, there were some new flux calculations. And there was a flux calculation, which is done by the Finnish group of Swan and collaborators. And in this case, they explain at least some part of this this bump, but they obtain a flux which is a prediction of the flux which is larger than the Huber-Muller flux, and this leads to an increase of the anomaly. So according to this calculation, the anomaly is even larger than what is was considered in the case of the Huber-Muller flux. Instead, another calculation which was done by a French group, they found instead the opposite. So they obtain a lower prediction for the flux, and this decreases the anomaly. And very recently, just a few weeks ago, there was a study by the Russians, Kopeikin and collaborators, in which they found that calculation, the so-called conversion method that was used in the calculation of Huber-Muller, must be renormalized for the flux of of neutrinos generated by uranium-235. And this causes a renormalization of the Huber-Muller prediction to a lower value, so that practically the anomaly disappears. So I cannot discuss this in detail, but the result of all this is that the status of the anomaly is rather uncertain, because we don't know what is the exact flux that is emitted by the reactor. So what we need to do is to find a way to measure the oscillations in a model-independent way. And this is done in the last generation of experiments, which measure the flux at different distances. So, comparing the measurement at different distances, they can see if there is a disappearance of electron antineutrinos independently on the calculation of the flux. And this is done in this experiment: NEOS, DANCE, Neutrino 4, Prospect, Stereo, and Solid. Here I just summarize the results of this. What is the implication for neutrino mixing of the results of these experiments, and showing that the situation evolved in the years. And in the 2018, the analysis of the data of these four experiments. So this is a Bouget 3 is an old experiment which uses the same technique, but in practice, it can only put a bound on the large mixing here. So these are the this region which are allowed in the plane of delta M square 4-1 versus UE4, so the mixing of the electron neutrino with the fourth mass eigenstate. So the Bouget curve here excludes what is on the right of this parameter space. The NEOS experiment instead found an indication in favor of oscillation, and that the allowed regions are all the regions inside this red ellipses. And also the DANCE had a positive indication, and these are the regions which are inside this magenta ellipses. So, so this is inside here, and also there are some small islands here. Prospect instead did not find any indication, and exclude what is on the right of this cyan curve. But here you can see that What was impressing in 2018 it was that there was a nice overlap of the allowed regions of NEOS and DANS here, where they also both experimented the best fit here. So this was interesting because also this region was not excluded by Bouget and Prospect. So this region was allowed, and in 2018 there appeared to be a rather interesting model-independent indication in favor of the oscillation because of the coincidence of the result of this two experiment, NEOS and DANS. But NEOS stopped taking data, so the NEOS data remained the same in the following year, but the DANS continued to take data. And in 2019, you can see that the indication of the DANS experiment is less strong in favor of oscillations because the allowed regions have increased. And compatibility between DANS and NEOS has decreased. So as a result, when we do the combined fit of all the data, you can see that in 2018, the combined fit indicated that the shadowed region, which were closed at 3 sigma. But in the using the 2019 DANS data, then the region opened, and at 3 sigma, also zero mixing is allowed. So this indicates that the indication in favor of oscillation has diminished. And if now we take the 2020 DANS data, and there was also some new result by Stereo, which excluded some part of the parameter space. You can see that the shadowed region, which showed the global result of the global fit, now allow zero mixing even at 2 sigma. So this means that at present, the global fit of the of this model-independent reactor data is not in favor of mixing. It allows the absence of oscillations at 2 sigma. So at present, in practice, reactor experiment exclude a large value of UE4 for a value of the delta M square in this range between about 0.1 and 10 electron volt square. So from we don't have any practically any indication, strong compelling indication in favor of oscillations. There was apparently a strong indication from the neutrino 4 experiment that I did not include in the previous fit because it is an anomalous result that is not reliable, as I will try to explain now. So the neutrino 4 experiment, they are still taking data. They have some detector which is mounted on rails. And it can move it at a different distance from the reactor. And the detector is also segmented, as you see here. And this is the result that they have shown. And you can see that this is a plot of the of the ratio of the number of events with respect to the average over all the distances as a function of L over E. And you can see that there is a clear dependence of L on L over E that is oscillating. So in this plot, maybe it is a little bit confusing, but the data are either the blue or the black points because they do two type of analysis of the data. One is using the so-called a binning of the data in energy or in bins of width of 500 keV. And the other is an average over different binning. So I think this second procedure is rather questionable and very unusual. So usually what one do is take one binning and analyze the data. So, and this correspond to the to the blue points, the blue triangles. So the blue triangles that are, I think, are the most reliable data are those that are obtained with a 5 kV binning. And instead, the red points are just the theoretical prediction using what the best fit in the case of the best fit value of the fit. So you can see that this is the best fit value for the mixing that is at a value of delta m squared, which is about 7 electron volt square, and at a very rather large value of the mixing, which is 0.26. You mean that this is you see that this is much larger than the values which we get here in this plot, which is at the level of 10 to the minus 2. This figure is seems to be a rather clear indication in favor of oscillations, and when they present the result in the plane delta m square 4-1 versus sine square 2 theta 1-4, then they get this allowed region at a value in a region of the mixing which is very large. So this is a very strange result because this means that if the mixing with a fourth neutrino is so large, then this is not a small perturbation of three neutrino mixing. So it is contrary to what I said in the beginning, that we can allow only a small perturbation of three neutrino mixing because we need also to fit the standard solar neutrino data and atmospheric and others using the only a small perturbation of the three neutrino mixing. And in fact, the one sigma and also the two sigma allowed the region here is in rather strong tension with the solar neutrino bound on the mixing with the mixing of the four neutrino. As you can see, the solar neutrino do not exclude the part of the region which is on the right of these vertical lines. And this is just in tension with this bound. Moreover, to put even more less confidence in this data, the last result that they presented had many changes. So, I mean, the last result was presented just the first time in May of last year. And if you look in the archive, there are 7 versions of this paper. And there is some variation of the best fit and also of the uncertainties of this best fit. But if you look at this column here, this showed the statistical significance that they estimate. And you can see in the beginning, the statistical significance was about 2.9 or 2.8. But then in February of this year, dropped to 2.4, then it decreased again to 3.2. And then now in the last version that I don't know if it is the final version, it is 2.9. So these people do not have clear ideas, I think, and they are just changing the analysis on the basis of some new idea. So I presented this result because I was impressed by the presentation of the last G-2 result when they you listened that they opened, they fixed everything, they opened the box, and whatever was the result, they published that result without changing anything. So this is really impressive, but this neutrino 4 experiment has a completely opposite behavior. Another problem of the neutrino 4 experiment is that as I will now show, is that they don't take into account properly the energy resolution of the detector. So they measure the energy resolution of the detector using some radioactive sources. And as you can see here, by using some sources of gamma rays, with a known energy, they measure some Gaussian distribution of the detected events. This means that the detector has some energy resolution, as all the detectors have, and it is not small. And so in the analysis of the data, one must take into account this energy resolution with a splitting function, which relates the true energy to the observed energy of the events. And in particular, one needs to average the oscillating probability, part of the probability, over the distance, over the size of the energy beams, and taking into account of this energy resolution function. And this has the effect of suppressing the oscillation, because and this is shown in this figure that I think I don't have time to discuss in detail, but if you want, I can explain it after the seminar if you do some question. So the result of this calculation is that is shown here. So in the, this plot here show the result of our fit of the neutrino for data in two cases. One is without the energy resolution, and this what we obtain are this allowed region inside this green and the yellow bands. So dark green is 1 sigma, then 2 sigma, and yellow is 3 sigma. And as you can see, this allowed region is compatible with the result of the neutrino for presented by the neutrino for experiment. So we get the best fit in the same point in which the neutrino for collaboration get the best fit. But we obtain that without considering the energy resolution of the detector. If we consider the energy resolution of the detector, then the oscillations are average. And this means that if to explain this observed large oscillation, one needs even larger mixing. And in that case, the mixing that we need is practically maximal. So the considering the energy resolution of the detector, the best fit is at maximal mixing. It is here. So it is the 1 sigma allowed regions are the ones within the blue lines. So this moves the allowed region even towards larger mixing, which is even more incompatible with the standard Trino-Tino mixing, with and with the bounds of other experiments, which are shown here by the black lines. But from one side, there is this effect that the mixing moves to larger value. But also the fit of the data becomes worse. And this is the fact that three neutrino allowed region now, the three sigma allowed region now is not bounded, and it includes also zero mixing, as you can see here. So at the 3 sigma, we get only an exclusion curve, which is the red one, and zero mixing is allowed. So taking into account the energy resolution of the detector, we apparently get more incompatibility with Trino-Tino mixing, but in reality, we get a better compatibility, because the Trino-Tino allowed the 3 sigma allowed region includes zero mixing, so it includes also the case of a small perturbation of Trino-Tino mixing. And as you can see here from this table, by including the energy resolution of the detector, the indication of in favor of oscillation drops from 3.2 to 2.7 sigma. This is not the end of the story, because we must take into account also the fact that all these regions and these p-values are calculated in assuming the validity of the so-called Wilks theorem, that Weil's theorem, which tells us that the test statistic that we use, that usually calculated usually called the chi-square, has a chi-square distribution. So assuming that the test statistic has a chi-square distribution, then one calculates this p-value, and one calculates also this allowed region by imposing the so-called delta chi-square, a fixed delta chi-square method. But this is completely correct procedure, because this Weil's theorem is violated in the case of neutrino oscillations, and the reason of the violation can be understood in the following way. So when we fit, I mean, when we have this data, the data fluctuates. And if we have we want to fit this data with a oscillating function, then it is always better to, I mean, more easier to fit the data with an oscillating function than without it, even if the fluctuations are not due to the oscillation but are just random fluctuations. So fluctuating data can be fitted better by an oscillating function. And this is a false indication in favor of oscillations, because there are no oscillations, just the data are just fluctuating. And this can be shown, for example, in this way. Is shown in these two plots, and for example, let us consider the plot on the right. This plot shows the distribution of the best fit point for a larger set of random synthetic fake experiments, in which the data have been generated without the routine oscillation. So the data are just, the fluctuation of the data are just random fluctuations. And then they fit the data with the neutrino oscillations. And normally one would expect, since the data are generated in the case of no oscillations, that the best fit should lie at a very small mixing. So at the limit at zero mixing. Instead, you can see that the best fit point in the case when they generate 1.5 10 10 to the 4 event lies here in this region. So this means that we get some false indication in favor of oscillations, just because the fluctuation of the data are fitted better by this oscillating probability. Increasing the number of events, the effect diminishes, because you can see that the best fit region shift on the left. And of course, asymptotically, this region will move to the correct zero mixing region. But when you have some fixed number of data, then you are in this situation. And this is the situation of the neutrino 4 experiment, as I show here. We generated some random data using the configuration of the neutrino 4 experiment, and we found that the best fit distribution is of this type. So as you can see here from this table, there is these data are generated without oscillations. So the fluctuation of the data are better fitted for a mixing, which is between 0.1 and 0.5 in the most case of this fake experiments. And there is also a non-zero probability to have about 20% probability to have a best fit just at large mixing. And this is the case that we have in the neutrino 4 experiment. So in the Neutrino-4 experiment, now if we consider the energy resolution and we make a calculation of the allowed regions using this a numerical simulation, which is not based on the Wilks theorem, then we find that the allowed regions move towards lower mixing, as is shown in this figure. So in this figure, you see that the allowed regions using the Wilk theorem, so the standard delta chi-square method, are those with the dashed within the dashed lines, and the corresponding numerical evaluation without Wilk's theorem are the solid line with the same color. So you can see that this region here is moved, extended to much smaller mixing, which is more compatible with the standard trino-trino mixing. And the in the significance of the neutrino 4 signal, sigma drops from 2.7 to 2.2. So at the end, the indication of for neutrino mixing from neutrino 4 that seemed to be more than 3 sigma, now is just at the level of 2 sigma. And I think it is not a strong indication. And of course, future experiments must check this this signal and see, I mean, either exclude it or prove it, but in a better way. I don't have much time. I just want to just to mention that it is possible. So we have seen that there is a statistical problem in the extracting information on neutrino oscillations on the mixing of the I mean for active sterile neutrino mixing using neutrino oscillation data, because we have this problem of the statistical fluctuation of the data that can be fitted better with the an oscillating probability. There is another method to find the mixing of the electron neutrino with the fourth neutrino, that is to see the effect of the fourth neutrino in the beta decay where electron neutrino is produced. And this is a robust method, because now we don't fit any oscillating function. We fit just a function which is shown here. So in this case, what we fit is some data for the kinetic energy of the electron, which is emitted in the case of most experiment in tritium beta decay. And as you can see, the spectrum of the electron here is can measure, as you probably know, the masses of the light neutrinos, which is which are compactified in this effective neutrino mass. But if you go to farther from the end point of the spectrum here, you can see a kink of the spectrum if there is a fourth neutrino which has a mixing with the electron neutrino. So by looking at this distortion, one can see measure the mixing of the fourth neutrino and also the mass of the fourth neutrino in a way which is more robust than the one with oscillation data. So far, there was, I mean, some experiment have been done, and the Mainz and Trotz experiment found some limit on this mixing. And most recently, the Kathring experiment also analyzed the data, and they found the mixing of the of the electron neutrino with the four neutrino that is shown here. Actually, we did this analysis before them, because in the first when they published the data, they considered only the three neutrino mixing. But we found we analyzed their data in the case of 3+1 neutrino mixing that and exclude found some exclusion region, which is exclusion curve, which is shown here. And last year, also the neutrino the Kathring collaboration has done this analysis, and they publish a more or less a similar exclusion curve. And you can see that This exclusion curve excludes the large mixing here, and it is close to the region here, which is claimed by the neutrino for collaboration. So in the next years, the cutting experiment will be able to test this claim of the neutrino for experiment in a more robust way. So in the last 5 minutes that I have, I just want now to discuss very briefly the global situation, in which now so far I consider only the reactor neutrino anomaly, but now we need to consider also the LSND anomaly and the results of experiments concerning also the new mu disappearance and the new mu to new E appearance. And yeah, okay, very good. Okay, yes, that I think is where I arrived. So we need to take into account the global mixing, and in this case, we must take into account that we know that UE4 is small, because we have seen that new disappearance is small. Now we have a bound on this value from the reactor. As we will see, also new disappearance is small and UE4 is small, and this means that the amplitude of new mu to new E transition is quadratically suppressed. Then this generates the so-called appearance and disappearance tension. And this is the a summary of the appearance data for new mu to new E. And you can see that a global fit of this appearance data show a region here. And in particular, there are several experiments which found excluded the mixing at large mixing, but and only the LSND experiment has some closed curve here, which is in blue, and the mini boon experiment has some closed curve here. But you can see that the mini boon experiment indicate a mixing which is rather large. And also this create a problem. So it's not fully compatible with the bounds from the other experiments. And I just discussed briefly the mini boon experiment, that if I can speak still for 5 minutes, it's okay. Because I think we are beyond the time, okay. So the mini boon experiment was made to check the LSND experiment. And what they had is an experiment which had a distance and the energy about 10 times larger than LSND. So they made an experiment which explored the same range of L over E, thinking that if they found an evidence of neutrino oscillation, this would be just a smoking gun, because they have a similar L over E of LSND, and no other explanation can explain this coincidence. But the problem is that they did not have money to make an ER detector, so they have to rely only on the far detector. And they operate in the range of energies in which the flux prediction is very difficult, and also the cross-section is not very well known. So their analysis is subject to large uncertainties for the beam and the cross-section, and also for the background, because they cannot fix the background by comparing near to far detector. So they have to make a so-called absolute measurements that is shown here. And these are the data in the antineutrino mode and this in the neutrino mode. And you can see that the data are just here in this region, are just slightly above the background, which is very large. And this is the region where they expect the LSND signal. As I discussed here in this slide, so the LSND excess was observed for a ratio L over E less than 1.2 meter per MeV. And considering mini boom, this means that the LSND excess correspond to an excess that must be observed above about 450 MeV. That is more or less on the right of this blue line. But you can see that here the excess is very small, and taking into account the uncertainty, it's not clear if it is a real excess or just a fluctuation. So the mini boom could not either confirm or exclude the LSND, and in addition, they have this very large excess at low energy that is called the mini boom low energy anomaly. But this excess is not very well compatible with the LSND signal because it is at, in another range of L over E. And also in these lower bins, you can see that the background is larger. So, and especially there is doubt on the on the possibility that there is a larger background from photons. And in this experiment, they look at electron neutrino events, but they cannot distinguish electrons from photons. So if you have a background from photons, they contribute to the electron antineutrino events. And this is a confusion. And so there is possibility that this background in reality is larger, and then it can explain at least part of this low energy excess. In principle, this low energy excess should be have been checked by already by the microboom at FNAL that was constructed several years ago and worked for several years, but so far they did not produce anything on this. And because they had many technical problems, and I don't know if they will ever check this anomaly. Oh. Again. Can you hear me?
Oh, yes, I can hear you.
Carlo? Carlo? Carlo.
Okay. Okay. So, yes, I was discussing that the mini boom experiment has this anomaly, and probably it has some, I think, other explanation. And here I show also some plot that is presented by the mini boom collaboration in their paper, in which they claim that their result is confirmed the LSND result. But in reality, as I wrote in the previous slide, you can see that the LSND excess was observed at L over E smaller than 1.2. And in this plot here, you can see that the LSND points are the green squares. And practically, the excess is here. So here they show also some additional point, but the uncertainty is large. So here there is the excess is not so clear. But so the LSND data extend here, but the data which concern the low energy mini boom excess are those here. So they are in a range which is just outside the LSND excess. And as you can see here, to explain this data, one need a very large appearance probability. And this means very large mixing of the active neutrinos with the sterile neutrino. And this corresponds to a mixing which is not allowed by other data. So the one can say that the mini boom data are compatible with LSND, but they are show some oscillation which are at a at a, with a mixing which is much larger than that is needed by LSND, and it is incompatible with the bound from other experiments. We need to take into account the bound for other experiments, and in particular from the new mu disappearance experiments. And for that, there are many experiments which obtain the bounds in this now on this mixing U mu 4. And as you can see, the combined data here limit U mu 4 to be smaller than about 10 to the minus 2. So this mixing is small. And in this channel, there is no any anomaly. So all the experiments put a bound on the disappearance of new mu at a short baseline. And this generated the so-called appearance-disappearance tension, because if we consider the smallness of UE4, the smallness of UE4, then we get a bound on this quantity from the disappearance experiments. And this quantity is the amplitude of the appearance, which is measured by LSND and maybe miniboom. So this is shown in this plot. So in this plot, now it is the delta m square for one versus I square to theta e mu, which is just the product of these two quantities. So this the region in this within this blue line is the region which can explain the LSND anomaly. But if we take into account the bound from the appearance from the disappearance experiment that I shown here, then we the region which is on the right of this red line is excluded. So you can see that most of this region, which is allowed by the appearance experiment, is excluded by the disappearance experiment. And we have only a small overlap here at the 3 sigma. So this shows that in any case, there is a tension between these two set of data. And this is a figure which was done in 2016, so using the data of 2016. And already at that time, the so-called parameter goodness of fit, which can quantify the tension between two different set of data, was very small. So it is it was at the level of 10 to the minus 4, which is a very small value, which shows a strong tension. After 2016, the situation became much worse. And as you can see here, I showed a similar result of fit in 2019 using the 2019 data. So in 2018, this was the time in which, as I discussed it before, there was some disagreement of the data at the time between DANS and NEOS, which indicated some very specific value of delta m square, which was preferred. So at that time, the disappearance data allowed only these small values of delta m square, which are within these red lines. And the combined fit with the appearance data is here, but you can see that there was a tension in any case between the disappearance and the appearance, and the parameter goodness of it was 10 to the minus 7. Using the later data in 2019, then this agreement of NEOS and DANS disappeared, and now we have again some bound from the disappearance data, which is does not point to any specific value of delta m square, and exclude what is on the right of this red region. And now you can see that this is really far from this allowed region. And if we make a global fit, it gives some allowed region here, but they don't. It's not completely not believable, because the parameter goodness of it is at the level of 10 to the minus 11. So I think that at present, this global fit, we cannot say that 3 plus 1 neutrino mixing can explain all this data. And we must find what is the, I mean, first of all, check if the LSND signal and maybe the mini boom signal is correct, and then understand if maybe there is some, if they are correct, there is some other explanation. And the problem, I mean, of the this anomaly, the LSND anomaly, will be checked it, with, we hope, in the definite way in the new experiments, which will be done in the next year. Yes, and these are the short baseline neutrino program at Fermilab, and you can see that they will this time they will have a near and a far detector, so they are not making the mistake of mini boom to have only one far detector. They will have a near and far, and they, so they will check this LSND signal in a model independent way in a hopefully in a definite final. Way, and you can see that their sensitivity here is well studied to check well this appearance region here. There are also other two projects in Japan, the New Prism and the JNS Square, that will also be sensitive, so they can also check this appearance. And most important is what if the, as I explained, if there is a new appearance, new mu to new appearance, we need also to have a new mu disappearance and new disappearance. And in particular, for new mu disappearance, we need to find some new mu disappearance that was not found now, so far in any experiment. And this experiment so can check, can find also are sensitive on this new mu disappearance, and but if they will find some value, it will be incompatible with the present bound, which are given here by the shadow weight region. So there will be a tension with the present bound, and then if they found a positive result, we will need to understand which of the present bound is wrong. So it means that some of the what we think are the present bound of the new disappearance are not correct, or maybe there was some very unlucky statistical fluctuation. So the conclusion is that regarding the reactor neutrino anomaly, the situation is that now the anomaly is disappearing. And as I explained, the neutrino 4 claim of large of oscillation is not reliable, and we hope to test in a model independent way the mixing of the electron neutrino with a four mass eigenstate in beta decay experiments. And I did not have time to explain, but also neutrinoless beta decay are sensitive to this mixing. And regarding the global status, also here there is a very strong appearance disappearance tension that so, and we need to check in a definite way the LSND indication in favor of neutrino oscillations, and to find the explanation of the mini boom low energy anomaly. And for that, these new experiments at Fermilab lab are very good, because these are done with liquid argon time projection chambers which distinguish the event of the photon from the events of the electron. So they can solve if the low energy mini boom anomaly is due to a photon excess, which is at present the most likely reason that we can find. Okay, I think I finish, so we can go to the discussion if you have some questions. Thank you.
Okay, thank you very much for the detailed talk. Are there questions or comments?
Yeah, ciao Carlo. I'm wondering if LSND and a mini boon are actually not so so well compatible because of the different L over E's. Why do their allowed regions overlap fairly well in the plot? like in the fit of mixing angle versus delta m squared?
Well, let me maybe say again that I'm not saying that they are not compatible, but they are not exactly the same signal. So there is a compatibility because you, as you can see from this plot here, you can fit both the LSND excess, which is given by the green square, and the mini boom low energy anomaly, if you allow some oscillation, which is very large, because you can see this is the black line is a correspond to a mixing which is very large. So there is a compatibility if we allow very large mixing, but then we are in this region. So the region which is preferred by mini boom is the one within this red curve.
But that's not terribly large mixing, no? I mean, they're in the region of this colored, of the yellow-green ellipse. They seem to be nicely within the same contours, and we are at 10 to the minus 2 or 10 to the minus 3.
But there is a vertical lines.
Yeah, the vertical line is from the Icarus opera and exclude what is on the right. But here you can still have
excluded. Okay.
But this is not, I mean, apparently it's small, but it is not small because as you can see from the other experiments, from the disappearance experiment, so you can see this region is at the level above 10 to the minus 3 here.
Mm-hmm.
The disappearance limit, if you go here, the disappearance limit is well below 10 to the minus 3.
Mm-hmm. Yeah, okay, that's clear, that's clear.
Mm-hmm.
So what I want to mean is that if we consider only the appearance data, then, okay, we can allow LSND and mini boom, also the low energy anomaly is okay. We can fit both, but then we will have a very large mixing, which is incompatible with the, however, with the disappearance data, and also mm-hmm. with this perturbation of three neutrino mixing, because now we will need we will have some effect in the solar neutrino data, which is excluded in other data. So I think so this low energy anomaly is not compatible with oscillations if we take into account the global picture.
So could you show your on last slide? The last one, the conclusion part.
Yes.
So here's the you have you listed the third item, alternative explanations with heavy stellar neutrino decay in the detector. So is that this for example the scenario by Pedro Machado's group or Silvia Pasquale's group that belong to this category?
Yes. I did not have time to this, but there is this possibility that there is a heavy sterile neutrinos which then decay in the detector and generate this low energy excess in mini boom especially, but also in LSND. It's possible.
Right.
In some scenarios, it's possible to explain both mini boom and LSND using this heavy sterile neutrino, which, however, must have some special interaction because it detects in an appropriate way to simulate the events. There is also an older scenario studied by Ginienko. I don't know if you know that. He considered also a heavy sterile neutrino, which have a very large magnetic moment, and so it can decay radiatively and simulate these events. it's interesting that all the alternative explanation involve a sterile neutrino, because yes. you need some new particle which is produced in the detector.
Mm-hmm.
And this can be only some sterile neutrino, because this new particle must be produced by the neutrinos which arrive. And, so it must have some mixing with the neutrino and be produced there and then decay.
Mm-hmm. So the question is whether a sterile neutrino has a new interaction or not, in a sense, right?
Yes, yes. But I must say that these are more, I wrote ad hoc explanation, because they are just mm-hmm. explanation which are constructed only to explain the mini boon anomaly, or mm-hmm. maybe sometimes they can explain also LSMD, but they cannot explain some all other signals.
Okay, so so when does Fermilab SBM program start to run?
I think that the Icarus, so they have a far detector which is Icarus, which is already in place, and they already show they have already taken some data, but they don't have the beam. Mm-hmm. So I think what is now under construction is the beam and the near detector. So they need to construct a new liquid argon near detector, and this is under construction. And as far as I remember, everything will start in 1 or 2 years, but I don't remember exactly when. Mm-hmm. But there was a discussion, presentation about this in the last Neutel conference. So if you are interested, you can go to look there.
Mm-hmm. Thank you.
You're welcome.
What's the status of your suggestion for the standard model explanation for the mini boon low energy excess together with Ioannisian? I seem to have read some vague statement somewhere that the mini boom people claimed that they actually had taken this into account. Can you comment?
They did not take completely into account. This is now I cannot explain because it's rather technical. I will need to have a separate seminar because it's technical, but they did not take completely into account this background. If there is some excess, so what they do is to infer from the, because they measure also some other signal from the pions, they can infer what is the number, because this delta decay also into pions. So, and they measure the pion signal, and they can infer what is the gamma signal from the pion signal. But the effect in the nucleus is different from for the gammas and on the pions. So there are some nuclear effects which need to be taken into account, and there is some uncertainty in there. So what we considered is some extreme possibility that can enhance this gamma background. That is maybe it's occur, but it is difficult to. It's necessary to make an experiment which can distinguish electron from gamma, like micro boon, and we hope some other experiment in FNAL that will solve this signal. I think I think the solution must come from the experiment.
Just a last question. Have you been in contact with the neutrino 4 people? I mean, it sounds like a rare experimentalist who is not aware that they should take into account the detector resolution in their analysis.
Well, maybe I can. I just went over one slide that is interesting on that. I had some contact with them, but not very good. And lately, I sent them a message, but they never answered. And you remember that in the last paper, they had 7 versions. And so our paper was in the done in January, I think, of this year. Then they have 2 versions in which they completely ignore our paper. And in the last version, they write a sentence about our paper, about the resolution, which is really disconcerting. This show that they don't understand what they are doing, because what they write is the simultaneous usage of energy interval delta A 500 keV and energy resolution is incorrect because it includes into analysis the resolution of the detector twice. It is what's done in our work. But this is completely wrong. It's easy to understand because, so they think that the energy beaming taking into account the energy resolution, but it's clear that this is not possible because so the energy beaming is just some way to collect the events and in some energy beams. But if there is an energy resolution, then it means that some event which has some unknown true energy in which the true energy is some in some unknown energy beam. But since we have an energy resolution, this can be counted in another beam. So we need to take into account the energy resolution, which can move events from one beam to another. And this is very well known. It is done in all analysis of the data. This is obviously not simply taken into account by the beam. So I'm very surprised by this sentence that you can find in the paper. So I am astonished that they can write such a thing. So that is all that I can say. So
yeah,
I don't know.
That's indeed disconcerting, I agree.
Are there other questions or comments?
I had a question about flux deficit anomaly. You mentioned that say neutrino mixing may explain, and the oscillation may explain the deficit of the reactor flux, anti-neutrino flux. But could it be changing the if you look at the energy distribution of the neutrino flux, can it be changing the shape of the spectrum? I mean, if you put the 1 electron volt strain neutrino to mix with an electron neutrino, then some specific the anti-neutrino at specific energy can only be oscillate into a strain neutrino, and that deforms the shape of the energy spectrum.
Yes, that is what is done by these experiments that I discuss here. So they not only study the rate at a different distance, but they measure also the spectrum. So they compare the spectrum at a different distance. So they can see both the different variation with the distance and also distortion of the spectrum due to the oscillations. But these are the experiments which are just very good to test these short base and oscillations. And they are at shorter distance. So they are at a distance from the reactor, which is about 10 meters, so dance, neutrino 4, stereo and solid, and auto prospect, the distance is about 10 meters from the reactor. What I discussed before about this bump, instead of concerned observation at a much larger distance, that is the near detector of these experiments, the Reno, Double Show, and Diabay, which are at 500 meters. So mm-hmm. at 500 meters, the distortion is average. So you don't have distortion because the oscillations are average. So you can say, mm-hmm. see this distortion if you are here at this distance. Mm-hmm. When you are here, the short baseline oscillation cannot generate this distortion. I don't know if you were thinking about this. Is it?
Yeah, well, what I was thinking is if you, in a specific, if you look at the specific experiment, like Reno or mm-hmm. Something else, but so basically you see the antineutrino spectrum as a function of the energy of antineutrino, and then if you put the detector at the specific distance from the reactor, then you know that what energy of the neutrino can be oscillate into a state neutrino. That's a kind of rough picture, but then I was wondering if such a deviation in a spectrum itself can show some indication of the state neutrino oscillation. Yeah. And
No, maybe I should explain why there is this averaging, because mm-hmm. every detector has some energy resolution. So mm-hmm. if you are very far away, then the oscillating function within the energy resolution, the oscillations there are many oscillations within the energy resolution, so you cannot see the oscillations.
I see.
But this means that the observable probability oscillations are average. So here you cannot, at this distance, you cannot see the oscillations because you have a finite energy resolution.
I see.
The energy resolution, mm-hmm. then you can maybe see some oscillation, but you should improve the energy resolution at a level not done in this experiment, and cannot be done now with the present experiment.
I see. And somehow related to my previous question, but it seems the standard model prediction, I mean, Huber-Muller model gives a very small error bar, but I don't know how plausible that you get such a small error bar as a standard model prediction. If you have any comment on that?
Well, the claim, the accepted error was about 3%, between 3% in the prediction. And this was for many years. So even before they thought that the uncertainty was at a level of 2-3%. And because they rely on this conversion method, which follows from the measurement of the electron spectra done in the but and others. And
yeah.
They think that the error induced by the conversion method is very small. And there was a paper by Peter Vogel about that. But then they discovered this 5 MeV bump, and they questioned error. And one reason that is a source of error is that when they do the conversion, they have to consider what is the spectrum. I mean, they must relate the spectrum of the electron, the neutrino, of the electron. And to do that, they must consider which type of decay, beta decay, produce these particles. But you know that in beta decay, you have the allowed transitions that are the most probable, but you have also the forbidden transitions in which the particles are not emitted by in S wave, but they are emitted in P wave. And in that case, the spectrum is different. And many of the, since these electron neutrinos are produced by the decay of many nuclear levels of different nuclei. Some, many of them are for the forbidden, due to forbidden transitions, and so the connection is not the same as the in the allowed transition. And in particular, this Finnish group, they have considered the correction due to the forbidden transitions, and they have found different results. So that is why after this discussion, people increased the uncertainty at the level of at least 5%.
Yeah, that gives me such an impression that previous estimated error had some hidden systematic, and you know, which people haven't noticed.
Yeah, the uncertainties were underestimated.
I see. I see. Thank you.
You're welcome.
Any further questions or comments? If there are no more questions, then we might thank Professor Carlo Giunti again.
Thank you.
Thank you.
Thank you. Let me close the conference room.
Bye.
Bye-bye.
Bye.